Okay, let's get started. I'm assuming everybody can hear me because I can't hear anybody, but I know that's because your microphones are muted. Oh, thank you. First of all, welcome to the Gilbert Kramer's graduation ceremony. First we'll have his presentation as part of the ceremony. Afterwards, there'll be a defense. After the defense, we'll announce whether we have a new engineer among our midst and what possibly how well he's done. Some very brief words. First of all, it's been a great pleasure for me to have Gilbert here. He came to the Economic Engineering Group here at Systems and Control. When he came, it was still a very, very, very new group. What we do is we model economic systems in the same way as we model engineering systems. Just to give you a brief idea what that entails, mechanical engineers, the most important thing for them is an inertia, a mass. The characteristic of a mass is that it maintains a velocity, that it's hard to change its velocity. Electrical engineers, you are right next door to us, they will look instead of an inductor. What does inductance do? It maintains an electrical current. We are a group that's called economic engineers. What do we do? Well, we look at the thing that's most important for economics. That's the question of demand and supply. What does demand do? Well, it maintains a flow of goods. We can see all these different fields, mechanical, electrical, and now also economic, as entirely parallel or analogous, as we would say. We can build mathematical models for economic systems and integrated econo-mechatronic systems in the same way with the same tools that we use to model all our regular engineering systems. This is a very new idea, and Gilbert is one of the pioneers in this work. He has worked with Ortec Finance, and we're very happy to have the head of research at Ortec Finance here, also part of his thesis committee, who will judge the work on its applicability in the activities that Ortec Finance has. In addition, we have two members of our own staff, Professors Tomasz Kawiczki and Professor Manon Koch, who will be judging it on its academic merit. Then we have myself, Max Mendel, and I'm the advisor of Gilbert. Gilbert started a friendly horse race with Ortec that, in good systems and control traditions, went entirely out of control and has become, I think, the biggest bond graph and dynamical systems on this side of the Mississippi River, or maybe I should say the Rhine River. I think it's time for me to stop talking about what Gilbert has done, but instead hand over the microphone to Gilbert himself. Please, Gilbert, you can tell us all about your research. Excuse me.
Yeah. Thank you, Max. I hope you can hear me too. Yes, perfect. Thank you for coming to my final thesis presentation. During my thesis, I've taken an engineering gray box approach to macroeconomic scenario modeling. With the model I developed, I performed time and frequency domain analysis of the macroeconomic system at hand. For my thesis, I've used the United States economy as a test case, but the approach can be applied or taken to model other economies as well. Before I move on, I'll explain the title a bit further. I've taken an engineering approach, like Max explained, specifically an economic engineering approach, which is in contrast to the econometric or economic approach. By taking or using economic engineering, I have taken a gray box approach, which is then in contrast to the black box approaches, which are currently being used and developed in industry. Since I followed an internship at Ortec Finance, I was able to evaluate their models. What Ortec Finance does is they, among others, develop these macroeconomic scenario models, which are able to forecast or generate certain economic scenarios. They can then sell these scenarios or the model themselves to their clients, who then use these outcomes to support their own investment decisions and hopefully make money. So since I've used the gray box approach, I had variables and parameters that have economic interpretation, I was able to perform time and frequency domain analysis using engineering tools. So that brings me to the goals of my thesis. So I want to develop an interpretable model of the dynamics of the US economy. In this case, interpretable is then the gray box approach. And with that model, I want to perform macroeconomic scenario and system analysis. And since I've used an engineering approach, I use engineering tools to do so. So I've subdivided this presentation in four parts. In the first part, I'll talk about the current modeling approaches. So in this case, the approach for Ortic Finance and state its limitations. I'll then go to part two, where I explain my economic engineering approach to model this system. In part three, I will present my developed gray box model of the US economy. And then in the last part, I will show how this model can be used to perform intuitive macroeconomic scenario modeling and analysis using engineering tools. So in the first part, I'll analyze or evaluate Ortic Finance's models and state its limitations. So during my internship, I've noticed that among econometrists or economists and engineers, the term for black box models can be somewhat different. So just to be on one line, I've used this definition from a nonlinear engineering book, which states that black box models are based solely on measurement data. Both model structure and parameters are determined from experimental modeling. No or very little prior knowledge is exploited. Now, in the case of Ortic Finance, they do exploit prior knowledge, but primarily so by manipulating or selecting or filtering their data in a certain way. So that's why we as engineers would classify it as a black box model. Now, without going in too much detail about the whole modeling methodology of Ortic Finance, I will state the main steps. So basically, they will start off with a big number of economic time series. These are then filtered down into three separate frequency bands using a frequency domain filter. And for these three frequency bands, three separate models are then developed. Now, they impose a dynamic factor model structure, which can be reformulated to a state space structure. They're quite similar, where the states or the factors are then obtained using principal component analysis, which is a reduction order technique that extracts the principal components out of the time series data. And this technique leads to latent states or factors. So the states do not have a clear, intuitive, direct economic interpretation. So the three models carry almost the same structure. So in reality, one of the models has been developed using a different approach by now, but for the sake of this thesis, I'll assume they're quite the same. And in state space form, they will look like this. And I'll mention a couple of important things. So first of all, at the left, you see the encirclements of the states or the factors. These are the ones that are latent and obtained using principal component analysis. And the second thing you see is that there are no measured inputs. So the only inputs to the system are the disturbance inputs. So the modeling only takes care of the autonomous response, the change due to initial conditions, since the expected value of these noise terms are zero. And that brings me to the limitations. So two things are quite important for Ortic Finance and their clients. First of all is, of course, the forecasting performance. But second of all is the interpretability. So how can you tune your model and explain that the outcomes of your model are the way they are? Now, with regards to the forecasting capabilities, I will not go into much more detail about it in this thesis, but I will deal with the interpretability issue. So one of the most important things is to include economic principles and laws into your models, because these laws and principles tell you the truths about your system, the way your system must behave. And this is quite difficult or time-consuming when dealing with black box models. So I will show in this thesis that using gray box models, I directly implement these economic laws to model my system. And only after that, I will start using data. Then the second thing is the shock or response simulation. So as I've shown you in the previous slide here, we only deal with noise disturbances and no real measured inputs. So now, for example, I'm a client of Ortic Finance and I want one of the outputs to be simulated in such a way that it is steered into a certain level, because one of the clients thinks that that is going to happen and they would require a scenario that does that. Now, for Ortic Finance, this becomes a quite iterative process to find out the combination of initial states and maybe change the input structure to cause this shock or this impulse response. And I will show with my model, with the gray box model, that since you have measured inputs, it is economically intuitive how you would imply or cause these shocks Then the last thing is closed loop scenario analysis. So this is non-existent in the current methodologies, and also due to the fact that you don't have measured inputs. And I will show that you can use my model to perform intuitive or economic and engineering intuitive ways to perform closed loop scenario analysis. So that brings me to the second part. And here I will tell you how I've used an economic engineering approach to build my gray box model. So the thing in economics is that many theories exist and they do not always agree, or actually they almost never agree. So since I'm the first one to ever build a model of an entire economy, I had to go find theory on which I could base my model, because that's what we do. We find economic theory, we build analogs to mechanical or physical theory or physics, and then use this theory to build our models. And I've used two separate theories that function as the backbone of my model, which are, in the first one is the national accounting theory. And this is actually a theory that's practically being used by governments to compute a nation's GDP, so the production of a country. And it can be computed in two different ways. So there's the expenditure approach and the income approach, and they're approximately equal. In the expenditure approach, you sum up all the expenditures of an economy. So GDP is the consumer spending, investment spending, government spending, and then there's net exports. So we're talking about the open economy. So the US is connected to the rest of the world. And then for the income approach, you sum up all the incomes. So there's rental income from land, there's profit income from entrepreneurship, there's net interest from capital, and there's wage from labor. And this is actually a good start for me, because it defines or gives me simple mathematical relations that define the most prominent cash flows within an economy. And it tells me somewhat how they are connected, but not really. How is, for example, the income approach connected or related to the expenditure approach? So for that, I've used what is called the circular flow theory. This is a macroeconomic theory that basically embeds the mathematical accounting relations in a visual way to visualize how these how the structure of a macroeconomic system looks like. So what we see in this graph in yellow are the economic actors, and in blue are the markets. So the markets aren't really specified here. I've used this from a book, a macroeconomics book. And what you see in green are the cash flow arrows. So these are basically the cash flows of the accounting relations. Now, what you don't see in this picture, but which is quite important, that for each opposite direction of these cash flows is a flow of assets or products. And that for me as an engineer is very intuitive, because we tend to think in systems acting in canonical variable pairs. So in momentum and position as analogs to prices and quantities, or angular momentum and angles as financial capital and interest. So you can imagine that these two theories combined give me a great start to model this system. Because they give me a clear mathematical relation, and they're quite simple. And they give me an idea of how this integral macroeconomic framework functions. But there are two big disadvantages. The smallest of them, too, is the fact that the market mechanism is not really defined. So this theory tells me that there is a market, but it doesn't really specify how these markets are interconnected, only that they are connected to the households and the firms. And another, actually the most limiting one, is that this theory assumes equilibrium. And I'm particularly interested in modeling transient responses and dynamic behavior, so not in equilibrium situations. But if we think of a physical system that is in equilibrium, that will mean that the net forces are zero, and therefore the system does not change. So momentum doesn't change, position doesn't change. So in economics, this would mean that prices don't change and inventory stock doesn't change. And this is a big limitation. But I was able to overcome it by thinking about it as an engineer. So what happens in a physical system when the system is not in equilibrium? Well, in that case, we do notice that energy is either being stored in elements or dissipated. And storage happens again in the form of prices or in the quantities of assets. And dissipation of cash flow is the outflow or the withdrawal of energy from this economic system. So what I've done to overcome this is, for each of the subsystems, define these energy storing and dissipating elements. Now, this might sound a bit abstract, so I'll come back to that. But the first thing I've done is I formulated a circular flow diagram of my own. And the most important things of this slide are the fact that I've decoupled the government from the rest of the economic systems. So in macroeconomics, the government is mostly modeled as an integral part of the economy. And the reason for that is that one of the principles of economics or macroeconomics is that each of the actors acts out of self-interest. So profits try to maximize their firms try to maximize their profits, and households, they try to maximize their utility. And this is basically an endogenous property of this system. So by modeling it in this way, it is part of the autonomous properties of the system. But the government does not do that, because the government acts based on a policy which is not out of their own interest, but is based on some exogenous interest. So an exogenous factor determines what the government does. So because they do not share the same internal dynamics, I've decoupled them and I've modeled the government as dissipative elements or external inputs. Now, the second thing important about this slide is the fact that I've distinguished two different domains. In blue, what we see is the financial domain, analogous to the rotational mechanical domain, where the canonical variables are financial capital and interest. And then in red, what we'll see is the economic domain, analogous to the translational mechanical domain, which is expressed in prices and quantities of assets. So assets can also be labor or quantities of rentals or whatever. So what I will do now is I'll give you an example of how I started modeling. And for this example, I've used the labor market. So from the circular flow theory, we know the labor market is connected to the firms on the one side and households on the other side. And what we tend to do in economic engineering is use bond graphs. So bond graphs is a graphical modeling method that directly implements a lot of physical laws and therefore economic laws. So I will not go into too much detail about how bond graphs work, but I'll give you a graphical example of how this modeling typically goes. So we know we have to change from the financial to the economic domain. So we use transformers. So at the right, you will typically have something like labor utility or intensity, sorry. And at the left, you will see labor utility. Now we know we're talking about the labor market. So there is a market. So I've defined a market element, a mass, which stores a price. In this case, the nominal wage. And then I define two different energy storing elements, which are called springs. And I then connected them to the market. So they basically store the demand and the supply of labor. And at the right, you will see what is human capital stores a quantity of full-time equivalents. And at the left, you will see the number of unemployed also stored as a quantity of full-time equivalents. And this energy is then dissipated in the form of incapacitation. So the labor force becoming inactive, which decreases the number of unemployed. And amortization, which is a kind of depreciation of intangibles, so depreciation of human capital. So I've done this for each of the subsystems, and it will typically look like this. So this is, again, for the labor market. And what you will see in red are the economic forces, or the economic wants, and in green are the flows of full-time equivalents. And just to give you an example of how this would typically work, so if we start at the firms will supply an economic growth rate, which then transforms into direct labor, which increases the human capital, therefore increases the nominal wage, and therefore decreases the number of unemployed. But this is typically how you would look at these systems in a dynamical way. Now, from the bond graph, it is quite simple to derive the state space model. So this is the state space model of the bond graph. We will have three states, two inputs and outputs, where they are connected to the firms and the households. And these are then internal inputs and outputs. And by doing this for all of the subsystems and interconnecting all of these subsystems, I would then get the model of my total economy. So this is what I will show you in this part. And additionally, I will show you that I wasn't able to model all of the variables that Ortic Finance proposed me to model. So I had to use a different approach, a frequency domain approach. So first, let's get to the model. This is the total model, the bond graph model. So without going into too much detail about all the independent elements, what you will see is that the basic structure is quite similar to the circular flow diagram, but I dynamicified it. So what you will see, there's eight subsystems. We have the households, the firms, the consumer goods market, the labor market, the rental market, a type of equity market, so a cash flow market, the loanable funds market, and then there's the government bond market. And the total system has 50 different parameters, 21 states, and I used 5 modeled inputs. Now, in reality, there are more inputs to the system. So you can think of many more inputs, such as, for example, the net outflow of wage of this system or the net inflow of rental income, for example. But the reason I use these 5 inputs is that the circular flow theory describes inputs that are the withdrawals or injections, so cash flow withdrawals or injections to the system. And since I want to stay close to the macroeconomic theory, I started with these 5 modeled inputs to model the system. But if you maybe want to identify the system, you can think of or have to maybe define other inputs to identify it correctly. So let's get to the five variables that Ortec Finance in the beginning once proposed me to model, as they give a good example or an overview of what a macroeconomic system should look like. So these are gross domestic product, consumer price index, the year-on-year total equity returns, and on the year-on-year yields for two different types of government bonds with different maturities. And with this time domain model, I was able to model two out of these five correctly, you could say. And the other three I wasn't able to model. And I will explain to you why I think this was the case or how I solved it. So in economics, there's two ways of computing economic variables, as there is in engineering. There's accounting, which is a form of integrating a value. So in this case, we're looking at the force or economic force from minus infinity up to zero to find the price at this time instant, or the momentum at this time instance, which is a time domain concept. This is embedded in the bond graph formalism I've used. But when we look at value, so equity value or the change of the value, or bond government bond value or the change of the value, we're looking at discounting, and this is what economists also do. They discount future cash flows with a discount rate, in this case the sigma, which is a real value discount rate, to compute the value at present, the present value. And if we look at this formula, it is very similar to the Laplace transformation, but for the real valued discount rate. So the Laplace transformation in engineering is inherent to the frequency domain. So I think these type of computations are inherent to the frequency domain, and is therefore only logical that I wasn't able to model these variables using my time domain model. So in my thesis, I've done this. I've used the Laplace transform to compute these variables. Now in this presentation, I will give you an example for how I did it for equity. So at the left, you will see how it's usually done in economics. In this case, there are different methods, but I've used the free cash flow to equity method, which discounts the free cash flow to equity. And this is the discrete time version, as in economics, usually a discrete time version because of the data is used. But since I'm dealing with a continuous time model, I've used the continuous time version of the Laplace transform. So what you see at the right is the Laplace transform. And the big difference here now is that we use a complex value discount rate. So we can also look at cyclical discount rating with the imaginary part. And by discounting the future cash flow of to equity, which is a variable that is an output of my time domain model, I'm able to compute the value of equity. But since I'm not so much interested in the value of equity, but actually in the change of that value, the year-on-year returns, I can use Laplace transform properties to compute the change of value as a frequency domain variable, which you can see at the bottom. So I was able eventually to compute all five variables that Ortec Finance proposed me to model. And I now have my model, and I want to show that I can use system and control engineering tools to perform macroeconomic scenario analysis, because that was one of the goals. So what I'll do, I'll show you three cases. One is a frequency domain scenario analysis. Another is a time domain open loop scenario analysis. And then I'll combine time and frequency domain for closed loop scenario analysis using root locus. So to give the overview, we start off with the economic laws. They're built in the bond graph formalism, from which I can derive my time domain model. We can transform it using the Laplace transform into the transfer functions, and I can use either to either perform time domain analysis, frequency domain analysis, or combine the two. So how did the idea of looking at frequency domain analysis start? Apart from the fact that Ortec Finance also uses a frequency domain to analyze or filter down the data. So in macroeconomics, there's this educational tool, it's become educational, which is called the ISLM curve, and it maps the transfer between interest rates and outputs, where the lines are then a kind of a supply and demand curve, where IS stands for this investment and saving, and the LM for the liquidity and money preference. So saving is the saving of an economy, and the money preference is the inflow of dollars due to the central bank. Now I've tried to recreate this figure with my model. So in the we're looking at a kind of a state trajectory, where I've mapped interest and GDP. I've given an impulse response on the open market operation, so on the buying of government bonds, which you see in red, and I've done the same, an impulse response on the savings supply. And what you will typically now see is that they are kind of alike, but this is not the intuition I had when I looked at this figure, because the way I viewed it was more as a frequency domain concept, where the interest rate is not now just some average interest rate, but is actually the discount rate. And this is also what's being done in macro or in economics in general, is that they use the average interest rate as an internal discount rate. But what we're seeing at the right is the bond graph that maps the open market operations to GDP. And as you can see, we're now looking at frequency and some output instead of a time domain concept. And to give you a better idea of this, I'll explain into more detail. So again, we're looking at the input monetary policy, which is discounted. It's a discounted cash flow mapped to another discounted cash flow, GDP. And I call this mapping efficiency. So we're then looking at the magnitude and the phase plot, which I gave macroeconomic interpretation. So the magnitude is then the effectiveness of your monetary policy versus the coincidence or the phase lag or lead that this monetary policy causes. And I gave some of these, I gave the idea of bond graphs and economic interpretation. So we can look at the resonance peak caused by a complex pole pair, which is the optimal trading frequency. So at this frequency, the effectiveness of open market operations or monetary policy is maximal. Or we can look at this anti-resonance peak, which is where the effectiveness of monetary policy becomes very low. So I called it the liquidity risk frequency. Or we can look at the corner frequency or the cutoff frequency, corner frequency. And at the corner frequency, what you see is if you increase the frequency of trading, your effectiveness goes down. So it's being rejected further on. And I therefore called it the liquidity risk frequency. So another thing I've done in my during my thesis, I've assigned the parameter values by hand. So I haven't used any data to identify the data, identify the model yet. What I've done is I've performed open loop scenarios and compared the step inputs of these scenarios to how economic theory would describe these scenarios. So in this case, we're again looking at the input of monetary policy. So at t is zero, I put a step input on monetary policy. So what does that mean? The government or the central bank, starts buying government bonds. And therefore, the government bond price increases. And as you can see, the bond yields drastically decrease. And because of the bond yields drastically decrease, the interest rate or the interest decreases, and we get monetary expansion. So we get a small economic upswing, as you can see. And this is kind of in line with how monetary policy works. So if monetary policy wants to expand, wants to perform expansion, they will typically have this reaction. Now, the last thing I've done, or I will show you in this thesis, is how we can also look at closed loop scenarios. So again, we're looking at monetary policy. And what I've done is I've used root locus. So we're now looking at a closed loop scenario where the static gain is varied from zero to infinity. So what you see at the top right is the closed loop response where the gain is one. So the buying of government bonds is not very aggressive. And you see that the effectiveness is quite low, which is in line with the Bode plot I just showed you. Now, if we start increasing this gain, so the government, the Federal Reserve starts buying government bonds more aggressively and aggressively, at some point what you see is that this pole moves into the right-hand plane and therefore becomes unstable. And this is the time response that corresponds to this instability. So what does this mean economically? Well, it means that you get hyperinflation. A government or the Federal Reserve actively or too aggressively buys, supplies money into the economic system and therefore destabilizes the economy by means of hyperinflation. So I've shown how this model can be used in different scenarios or in different ways to perform scenario analysis. And that brings me to the summary. So I'm the first ever to build a fundamental gray box model of a macroeconomic system. You can perform scenario analysis using engineering formalism and tools. So I've just shown a few, but of course the engineering toolbox is larger than that. And the generated qualitative scenarios show some promising first results. So to conclude, what does that mean for Ortec Finance? So to come back to the limitations I stated, we can directly incorporate economic laws, albeit with some research, but by using an economic engineering approach. So I've introduced a new way of scenario generation because Ortec Finance will typically look at the autonomous response, but now I'm including economically meaningful inputs. So you can start look at forced responses instead of just the autonomous response. So this is a new way of looking at scenario analysis. Then I've shown that with my model, we can perform closed loop scenario analysis in an economic intuitive way. So we can think of a closed loop scenario as being something real. And then I've shown how you can use a frequency domain, not only to filter your time series or to look at it from a quantitative view, but also qualitatively assess what happens in the frequency domain. And that brings me to the recommendations. So before, if you want to start using this model in a practical situation, you will have to identify your model using economic data. So that involves the collection of the correct economic data and also in the pre-processing and the extra research that has to be done in the identification techniques to do so. And of course, the next thing, once it has been identified, you can do is use the whole economic or system and control engineering toolkit and theory to perform scenario analysis.
Thank you very much. It was a very impressive presentation. And I immediately see Tomas, his hand is up. Please.
Sorry, that was an applause sign. But if you want, I can ask something quickly. I was wondering about your last slide when you say the next step would be system identification.
Yes.
You did use economic data for the dynamic scenario generator model. So I was wondering why you try to identify using that data a model. Is it simply a time issue? Or
yeah, it was a time issue. So the thing was, I was really stuck at, especially I wanted to model the equity returns and the bond returns for different maturities. And I had to make a choice whether I would start identifying the model without having correctly identified how to model these variables, or I would continue my research and first build a framework to do everything correctly before start identifying.
Thanks.
Any further questions? Quinton, he raised his hand. Yes. Quinton, please.
Yes, thank you for your presentation. At slide 21, you talked about cyclical discounting. Can you elaborate more what that will mean? Because that's a noun in economics.
Yes. So what you will see in economics is that there are business cycles. So if we look at a constant discount rate, that means that you are constantly discounting your future cash flows with a constant rate. But in reality, we will know that this discount rate also fluctuates due to the economic cycling. So what you can then do is use this imaginary part of the complex discount rate to also incorporate this cyclical behavior of the discounting. So it's a form of variance you introduce.
Right, and then follow-up question, what is the difference then taking the middle line of the normal path within discounting, only the real part?
Well, so then for at some time instance, so on average it will be the same, but at some time instance you can be at a different part in your cycle, so it can be much higher or lower than the actual discount rate you're now using due to the economic cycling.
All right, thank you.
Any questions? I'm sure there are.
Buzz.
Yeah, Buzz.
Yeah, hi, Gilbert. Thank you for the presentation. So you used a lot of tools in control theory, such as the Bode plots. And so they seem to imply that your whole system model you obtained was linear, right?
Yeah.
To me, that kind of says that apparently the whole economic system can be modeled as a linear system. Or do you think there are certain nonlinearities that you kind of assumed were not there, or like you know at which parts they
yes. Mean. So in engineering, what you will typically also do is try to linearize your system, even though the system is nonlinear, because then you're able to use all these system and control engineering tools and laws, basically. So in reality, I do think that an economic system is actually a nonlinear system. And I started modeling it directly as a linear system, also based on the fact that Ortec Finance uses a linear system to model this. But in reality, what we're probably looking at is a linearized version at some nonlinear point. So that also probably means that you will have to re-identify the parameters of your models every now and then.
Thank you.
Kunyao.
Thank you for your presentation, Gilbert. I just wonder, why did you choose to model the USA instead of the Netherlands? What would be the difference if you modeled the Netherlands instead of the USA?
Yeah, so when I started this project, one of the things was also, of course, that I would identify the model using data. And for the United States economy is well, you could say the economy where the most research has been done about the economy, and most data is available for the economy. So it is, in that sense, the best place to start, since we have a data, you could say, abundance compared to other countries. But if you want to apply this to the Netherlands, I think you can actually use the same type of model. Now the Federal Reserve has become the central bank of either the Netherlands or of Europe, and the government is then the Dutch government, since the dynamics will behave similar.
Thank you.
Hans, I thought I saw your hand up.
Yes, but it went down automatically. Well, first of all, Gilbert, of course, thanks a lot for impressive work and research that you have done, and also excellent presentation. I have a question for you, which kind of requires you to bring together the different fields that you have been studying and finding, and that's about the dimensionality.
Yeah.
As you know, models that we have at Ortec Finance, they aim to cover the global economy and all the asset classes. Huge volume of economic variables and asset classes together. And yeah, to be able to get good performance out of the models in terms of forecastability, in terms of realism and stylized facts, as we tend to call them. It's very important to keep dimensionality under control. You have now embarked on a route to see if you can add or improve the interpretability of the models. And I was wondering what your thoughts are about to what extent you have been able to keep the dimensionality under control.
Yeah.
Taking into account that you have only, between quotes, modeled the US economy and a couple of economic financial market variables, where again it should expand a lot more. So I'm very curious on your thoughts on dimensionality.
Yeah. So my goal, since I try to combine all these different frequencies into one model, since we're looking at a more interpretable model, we can define the different frequency for all the submarkets, is to come close to the sum of the states or the factors of all three Ortec Finance's models. So in that sense, I've came close, but of course, I haven't modeled everything that the models of Ortec Finance can model at this point. So I'm not really sure how the dimensionality will increase, but to be honest, I do think it will increase, because I have modeled what I think are the most prominent things that I need to model to get this system. So to model additional financial instruments, for example, would probably embark or include new energy storing elements and therefore new states. So yes, the dimensionality will increase from here on, but I don't think by a whole lot, because I do think you can also, for example, use this model not just for the US economy, but let it represent the whole world. But now the inputs, which I modeled as the inputs with respect to the whole world, become different. So now these are the inputs that are basically the growth of the labor force or the growth of the population, technology change, and land or natural resources discovery.
You start modeling other economies, like the Netherlands, for example.
Yeah.
Would not arrive at, let's say, multiples number of parameters that you have now, because you step towards, let's say, global economy driving the.
Yeah, so the best way I can think of right now, so if you want to include all countries, is you use this model to model the whole economy. So it's quite similar to how the approach is now taken for the trend model. So you use global data as the states, but then your C matrix, so the ones that relate the states to the outputs, maybe you can combine a gray box model approach with a black box model approach. So then you start parameterizing DC matrix based on the states with relation to your output series. So you have a combination of black box and gray box, but at least your parameters in your dynamic matrix are intuitive, and so are your factors or your states.
Any last questions? Well, if they're not, then what I'd like to do at this point is... is thank you again. And what's going to happen is, how shall we do this? Should we put everybody else in the waiting room or only move the... Sorry?
The committee will be put in the breakout room.
Okay,
the
so...
Just stay here and wait until...
Yeah, so what we'll do is we will usher the committee in a breakout room, and then we'll the committee will go into recess evaluating Gilbert. This will take approximately an hour, and then we'll be back. So please hang around for the official announcements and ceremonies. Well, thank you very much, and I'll see you in a little bit. So please hang on, the whole committee, because you are going, I love this part where you can just kind of usher somebody in and out.
Hands.
Manon.
And ourselves.
Oké, dan ga ik jou vragen of je gewoon bij Koen of... Oh.